Good morning, church. So good to see you this morning. Our Advent moment comes today in the Gospel of John. The Gospel of John reminds us that God did something to demonstrate his love, that he not only left his place, a perfect place, he came and dwelt amongst us as a baby. We're reminded of that today as we light our fourth Advent candle today, the candle of love. I want to share this scripture to you from the Gospel of John, where John tells us how he demonstrated this. Listen, he says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried out, 'This is he whom I said, he who comes after me ranks before me because he was before me.' For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen but God, the only God who is at the Father's side. He has made him known." What a beautiful scripture this morning. Let's reflect on that as we prepare our hearts for the coming of the Lord. Amen. All right. So we do have a couple of announcements coming up here. This Christmas Eve, we're going to start a new tradition. We're going to have our first Christmas Eve service ever here at this church. Normally, we partner up with other churches and go to their services. But this year, we want to do something new. You know, a lot of things have been disrupted this year, haven't they? A lot of traditions stopped or have been different. Why don't we start something new? And come and join us for a small, intimate service here at 6 o'clock on Christmas Eve. And we'll sing together. We'll sing his praises. And then we'll go on to Grandma's house for dinner or back to our homes and prepare our hearts for Christmas Day. If you're able to, we'd love to for you to make provisions to be part of that service. So looking forward to that. There will be candle lights. It'll be a candlelight service, and we'll end on a very peaceful note. That's the intent anyway. So make provision to be part of that. That's the announcements I have. I'll direct you to our website, www.sevillecommunitychurchofgod.com. That is the first place we update with any changes. We know.
There we go. Look down where he lay, the
right. We're going to have a couple places. Go ahead and be seated. We'll have a couple places Scripture's going to come from today, all to tell the Christmas story. Carly's going to share those two places with us. The first one is going to be in the book of Matthew, and she's going to read verses 1 through 18. And then the other one is going to be in the book of Luke, and that's going to be verses... That's going to be chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. So that one and then that one, okay?
Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. Okay, the second one. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary and betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. May the Lord add his blessing to the two scripture readings this morning.
Nice job. We'll have all the kids stay where they're at. We'll have you stay in the service today. Autumn's going to come up and join me here as we talk about the Christmas story a little bit. So normally, within Christendom, well, I'll get to that in a second. Anybody have a birthday this week? Got one there. All right. Got a couple of them. Let's sing happy birthday and then happy birthday to Jesus, right? Hello. Yeah, we better sing happy birthday. Ready? Let's sing happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Let's clap for the birthdays. Woohoo! Anniversaries, anybody celebrating an anniversary this week or next week? How many? 46. Awesome. Let's sing happy anniversary. Ready? Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary. God bless you. Happy anniversary to you. All right. One more round of applause for the birthdays and anniversaries. We love to celebrate those things that are worth celebrating, and certainly another trip around the sun is a gift from God that we should be grateful for, and doing that with the one you love is certainly a blessing on top of that. We're going to typically in Christendom, this would be the Sunday that we make all the kids dress up like shepherds and baby Jesus and the angels and Mary and Joseph and all that kind of stuff and sheep and cows and we bring them up here. It's Christian hazing is what it is. It's what you got to do to be in the club, I guess. But this year we don't want to share costumes and all that kind of stuff, so it's going to be a little different. The youth did prepare. They want to tell you the Christmas story here in just a few minutes. But before we do that, a couple things that were heavy on my heart this week that I want to share is how God is not surprised by anything. And what made me realize that, or what made me think about that, are dogs. Raise your hand if you got a dog. Yeah, you got a dog. You got a horse. How big is your dog? Yeah, talking. How much does he weigh? Czar's his name.
About 150 pounds.
Yeah, huge. And he's a puppy. He's a huge, huge dog. My dog weighs full grown, 5, 6 years old. He's like 12 pounds, 12 something. 12. She thinks she's 150 pounds sometimes. You know when she thinks she's 150 pounds? I don't know if Czar does this or not. But does he spaz out when somebody comes to the door?
Oh, yes.
Does he really?
Oh, yes.
Now, see, I would be afraid of him. I would really, 150-pound Great Dane, I would be afraid of that. But my little 12-pound dog is completely and utterly shocked every time the mail lady comes and brings us mail. It just, like she didn't know what was going to happen that day, just spazzes out and doesn't want us to be hurt because maybe she thinks she's protecting us. But for some, whatever reason, the mail lady comes up and she is surprised every single time to the point where she can be in a dead sleep, snoring and everything. But she hears the mailbox open and she is on it and runs up there and makes sure that the mail lady doesn't get into our house and take out our whole family. So we're grateful for that. It hasn't happened yet. What does Czar do? How does he act surprised?
He just runs to the door and wags his tail and gets down like he's playing or something. But our little Chihuahua, she's the loud one. She will sit there and bark and bark and bark.
Sure.
But
completely shocked, right?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, and it's important to remind us ourselves sometimes, especially in a time like this year, there's a lot of loss. There's a lot of surprises that we've had to go through, right? School shut down. Maybe we lose some of our loved ones. But it's comforting to know God is never like that, is he? God is never surprised. See, nobody gets to heaven and God's like, oh, I had no idea you were coming here. Oh, I had no idea I was expecting company today. None of that. He doesn't spaz out like the dogs do. He's not surprised by anything at all. He's not surprised by COVID. He's not surprised by sickness. He's not surprised by even loss. He's not. See, he knew it was all going to happen. None of it surprises him. And it's nice to know the person that's not surprised by anything. We can have a calm assurance knowing that he's got this. Whatever it is in our life, even the really, really bad stuff, God's not surprised. He's not surprised. He knew it was going to happen. He knew it was going to happen before you were even born, is what the Bible tells us. We need to reflect on that during this time, especially when schools, shutdowns get expanded and all that kind of stuff happens. We need to be reminded that God saw it all. He knew it was going to happen, and it's going to be okay. Now, it's important to remember that this time of year. So, you guys put together a little video for us to tell us what the Christmas story is. You ready to watch it? You ready? All right, we're going to watch it. All right, let's watch it.
The Christmas story is the angel gave you to CJ and he said that she will deliver Jesus.
Mary and Joseph
Mary and Joseph were sent to Bethlehem because
They had to go to their hometown for a census.
Today is a special day. Today is the day that we get to retell the Christmas story. One of the most important stories in human history. So we're going to take our break from our series in 1 Thessalonians to look at this story. And it's up to you, church, to tell this story, to tell it accurately. To tell the story to the next generation. See, we live in a time where the Bible is more accessible than it ever has been. You can literally get any translation you want, thousands of them, on your phone. And you know what? They'll even read it to you. But studies show that we live in a time where Bible illiteracy is an all-time high. It used to be when you were in school or I were in school, everybody knew who Jesus was, who Jesus is. It's not the case anymore. We know what Elf on the Shelf is. We know who Santa Claus is. We love Christmas trees. We know where Bronner's is at because that's where we get our Christmas ornaments every year, right? But it's up to us, it's up to the church to tell the story of Christmas. Make sure we're doing that. To help you with that, let's look at the Christmas story. But I want to go back. I want to go back a little bit farther where everything was perfect. A time where everything was perfect. A place called Eden. A place where God communed with his creatures. where lions laid with lambs, where food was prepared and made without the sweat of the brow. Work was pleasant. Work was enjoyable in the garden. And everything was perfect in the garden. Everything was perfect in the garden until Eve was convinced to do something she shouldn't do. Go ahead and advance that a couple times, Ray. Eve was deceived, and in that deception, sin entered the world. In that very moment, perfect became imperfect. See, it wasn't the act that she ate the forbidden fruit and gave it to her husband, Adam. It was the fact that they couldn't and they didn't trust God. That they wanted to do what was right in their own eyes. But here's the good thing about God. Here's the awesome thing we see about God. Even as he is cursing man, he promises redemption. Genesis 3, 14 through 15 says this, as the Lord is pronouncing a curse on the serpent, he says this. Go ahead and advance that, Ray. The Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and above all beasts of the field. On your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. Now, a translation there could be, he will crush your head, and you will bruise his heel. See, in that, God promised that from the foot of a man, redemption would come. But the world was altogether different. Indeed, it was different. It was broken. Population continued to increase. People groups became more divided. The world as we know it was taking shape. Men would spend the next several thousand years populating the earth and trying to do life without God, setting themselves up for a great disappointment. But occasionally, God would hear their prayers, and in those instances, he would listen. God even separated a people to be his very own, the Hebrew people. And through them, he would establish just how hard it is to be perfect, the standard of heaven. He sent prophets at various times throughout human history to remind the people of the promises he made. One of the most notable prophets was the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah says this almost 1,000 years before Christ was born. Almost 1,000 years before the birth of Christ, Isaiah says this in chapter 7, verse 14. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin will conceive and bear a son, and you shall call his name Emmanuel, which literally means God with us. Now, the Hebrew people would continue to repeat the cycles of calling out to God and falling away from God. Over and over and over. But in his timing, in God's timing, he would establish a new king in a new kingdom. One that would not take away, or one that would take away death's sting for good. And he would create a way back unto himself, to his own heart. The Christmas story. Setting up for the greatest human event in human history, salvation. Death on a cross. Where a teenage girl named Mary, when a teenage girl named Mary was approached by an angel, she had nothing. She was nothing, nothing special. But Luke tells us what happened. Luke 1:28 says, "And this angel came to her and said, 'Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you.'" Now, Mary was greatly troubled at the angel's greeting, but the angel reassured her that this was from God and that she would become pregnant, which confused Mary because she had never known a man. But this was an act of God. Like all acts of God, the help of humans is not needed. Luke 1:35 says this, "The angel answered her, 'The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called holy, the Son of God.'" But there was a problem. See, Mary was betrothed to a man named Joseph. Betrothal back then was just short of marriage, but it carried all the same legal implications. Now, there was two ways to break off a betrothal. One, a very public trial where it's very likely that Mary's angel story wouldn't carry any weight. She would be laughed at and certainly no evidence to the contrary, and could likely be stoned to death. See, in Hebraic law, adultery carried the death penalty. Betrothal, carrying the same connotations as marriage, and becoming pregnant while you're betrothed would carry a death sentence, or certainly could have. Now, Joseph had a decision to make. He was a nice man, and hard to say how he took this, but he decided in his heart to divorce Mary quietly, probably go to the family and break off the betrothal, to try to keep it as quiet as they possibly could. And he decided to do that until one evening in a dream, Matthew 1:20-23 says this, "As he considered these things," as Joseph considered breaking it off with Mary, "behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, 'Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.' All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, 'Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel,' which means God with us." Now, Joseph did the right thing. He did as the angel said. He stayed betrothed to Mary. Several months had passed by, and Mary went to visit her pregnant relative, Elizabeth, who was in her sixth month of pregnancy. Now, Mary stayed there, it seems, for 3 months, maybe to help Elizabeth around with chores and things like that, and left probably shortly after John the Baptist was born, the person that would actually prepare the way for Jesus, the crazy guy in the wilderness that wore camel's hair and ate locusts, who would yell to the people, "Repent. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." He told the people that Jesus was coming when he started his earthly ministry. But back before Jesus was born, a very pregnant Mary got the news from Joseph that Caesar Augustus ordered a decree that all the people would go back to their hometown, their towns of origin, to be counted. A census was going to be taking place of the entire Roman area. This means that every man and his family needed to return to their hometown or their family's origin to be counted. This translated into anywhere from a 5, depending on what route they took, to 10-day journey on foot back to Bethlehem. Now, a very pregnant Mary walked the entire way or rode on a donkey, we're not really sure. But by the time she got there, it became time for her to give birth to a baby. Now, presumably everybody heading back to their own hometowns made little room at the inns. Being turned away from a normal place where people would gather and sleep, they settled for where the animals sleep. Now, presumably because there was bedding there, maybe fodder where the sheep would lay or the other animals would lay. And the King of the universe was born there. The very being that spoke the entire creation into existence was born in the dirt. Certainly could have been born into a palace of the highest king of the highest land and the greatest nation. But he didn't. He settled for a lowly manger. And the news was first delivered to the lowest of the human caste. One of the lowest, probably a tick up from the beggar on the street, was the shepherd, the person that was in charge of taking care of the livestock. Not really able to go to functions and different things. Angels appeared to them. Luke 2:8-14 says this, and in the same region there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night, and an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were all filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all of God's people, or all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And then suddenly there was with the angel was a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." Then later on, sometime within the first 2 years of Jesus' life, wise men came and saw a rising star and followed it to a house where Jesus was. And so it was. And so it is. Jesus, fully God, but fully man, would do what we cannot ourselves do. Make a way back to perfection. See, God chose to step into his creation. To live a perfect life, you and I can't. And he would die a death that you and I deserve. To redeem a relationship we rejected. Take a moment now to ponder these things in your heart. If you have accepted this baby, there's only one thing left to do. Tell your neighbor. God chose this way. It makes no sense at all. From a worldly perspective, it makes no sense. It's foolishness. But if we really think about it, and heaven is a perfect place. That means that little white lie we told this morning, exaggerating the size of the fish we caught last weekend, calling in sick when we weren't, harboring that bitter resentment toward that family member, would bar us from heaven for eternity. But God didn't want that, did he? So he stepped into creation to do what we couldn't. May you be blessed by this in a new way this year. May you reflect on that in a new way this year. And may you tell your neighbor the greatest story in human history. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your Son, that we can't understand your ways, but we're grateful for them. Would you be with us this Christmas in a new way? Make your presence known in our life, Father. We love you and we have faith in you always. It's in Jesus' name we ask these things. And everybody said, amen. For leading us in that, let's close with a blessing. So I want to bless you. Keep your eyes right here. May God bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May you receive this baby like you've never received this baby before. Now go tell it to the world. Amen. Bless you all.